So when Martha first asked me to talk on this panel about social metrics and how that can start to fit within digital cities, I was giving some thought to this, and I turned back to one of the great 20th century philosophers of our day, from North America, a fellow by the name of Joseph Tribbiani. Right, you may be familiar with him, right? Who asked the basic question to many people of how you doing, right? And that's really what we're trying to get a hold of today. How are we doing in our urban environments? And as we discussed a little bit yesterday morning in the panel that I moderated, there are lots of metrics that are currently out there for a variety of environmental and social targets. Right? But just to name a few, the Global Cities Institute has a metric for looking at social sustainability. There's an ISO standard for indicators of city services and quality of life. Oddly enough, this is one of the few ISO standards that is not translated into French. I don't know what that means. The Rockefeller Foundation, my colleague Anne yesterday, briefly mentioned the Rockefeller Foundation's framework for resilience, which includes a number of social sustainability metrics and community-oriented ideas. And so in order to try to use many of these tools, we said, look, we have to take a step back and try to put some type of ontology and framework around this. And so we are currently in the process of writing a literature review paper that's in review right now, that tries to take all of these metrics and put them into some structure, some ontology that can help us design and think about what social sustainability looks like. And when we boil these down, we tend to come to a small number of specific goals and targets. And so the two I want to talk about specifically are safety and community, and what the literature tells us about how we design communities and cities for safety and community. Right, so there are lots and lots of ways to try to quantify something like safety. You know, emergency services, the availability of them or the response time, how we actually measure their availability or response, and then what the goal should be in that community. Similarly with natural surveillance, right? We can start to look through the literature and find all kinds of metrics that will point us towards notions of safety and whether or not we're supposed to take that measurement in the community, maximize it, minimize it, or shoot for some type of measure that is seen as acceptable to a local population. In terms of community, how do we design for community? What is the metric for community? Well, there are all kinds of metrics for community. The provision of educational spaces is one that comes up throughout the literature again and again. But is it the convenience of those spaces? Is it the usage of those spaces? Is it the availability of those spaces? And then what is the metric by which we actually measure that? Is it the availability of community centers? How streets are structured to be more social or less social. All of these are potential metrics for how we consider quality of life and the design of a community. And so we're putting those together in an ontology, right? For the goal of using them for design, right? Most of the tools that we've seen in the literature are for assessing existing communities, right? That's very nice to come up with a score, to come up with some idea of whether or not my community is sustainable or has a high quality of life. But of course, the thing we really want to do is go forward on design. So our approach is to take these types of metrics, incorporate them into something that Kevin Sue yesterday mentioned from Disney, put those into a multidisciplinary design and optimization framework for urban networks that are incorporating environmental, economic, and social metrics. And so what we start with is a very simple layout of a community. And so here we have a bunch of buildings that we can lay out on a grid network. And so as we start to increase the complexity of this network, we get to an actual urban landscape. And then we'll power that. And here we're looking at power flows, but these could also easily be people walking around these communities. And what we will do through that MDO process is not look at 3, 4, maybe 10 communities like a typical urban planner or design firm will look at, but rather look at not billions, not trillions, but rather 10 to the 15th, 10 to the 21st different communities. So we will look at a universe of different communities with different building types, different layouts, different walking patterns, and then pick from not the top 1%, because that's far too many communities to look at, but the top very, very small fraction of communities that we can look at. Here's an example of the kind of output that we see. This is a bit of a spaghetti diagram. But what we're looking at here is for just the very, very, very best communities in our optimization, the percentage of, so each one of these lines as it connects through for each one of these vertical sort of shafts is one very, very, very optimal community, very good community, right? And it shows how you can have, say, one community will have 50% residential, 15% office space, 20% commercial, and sort of move on through. And so we can see what the makeup of our communities will look like in terms of building type. And also, in terms of layout, right? So we're looking, once again, at many, many, many design alternatives and asking the question, how well are these communities doing? Right? And so we can get then 3D plots of a tremendous universe of communities in order to balance things like carbon emissions, community energy efficiency, and life cycle cost. But even more telling are plots like this. A Pareto plot, or a scatter plot in this case, we'll put a Pareto curve on it here shortly, showing community energy efficiency versus street score. Street score is a metric of urban social sustainability that came out of MIT. And so for all of those communities that we're generating, we're calculating a street score and asking the question, if we want to try to balance energy efficiency against street score, we now have a set of optimal communities to balance that. And these, of course, are just the best out of a huge universe. And what we see is that, you can get really energy efficient communities, except they are terrible to walk around. Why? Because, you're trying to cascade energy between different buildings. You're trying to do all kinds of very energy efficient things. The minimal amount of distance of moving hot or cold water, whatever it takes to keep energy losses minimal. But once again, it would suck to live there. And there are also communities that are incredibly walkable, but incredibly inefficient, right? And it's right in this sort of trade-off area that we really want to be. And that's where we're starting to try to push ourselves. Similarly, we can look at life cycle cost to build, operate, and maintain a community. And here you'll see these are negative numbers because, these are costs to do this. Versus that street score. And so we want to get to the least negative numbers, right? And so we can start to find communities that have very walkable metrics, but are achieved at the least possible cost. So just to kind of keep things quick and tight for you, Martha, my final thoughts on this and where we are going with this is many of us, most of us at least, have a general concept of what makes an urban space a high quality of life. The difficulty is, in design and optimization, a general idea is very difficult to work with. Right? Quantifying those appropriate metrics is very difficult, but some have tried, as I mentioned. But the real opportunity around digital cities is that setting appropriate targets and parameters for urban quality of life is a tremendous opportunity if that data is generated from people. We can see what types of streetscapes, what types of community attributes people really love. And then not only design new communities to use those, but design renewed communities in existing urban areas that will leverage that even more. The new streams of data that we have coming are allowing us to better and better understand ourselves and what we want out of the cities that we build and that we live in. And then equipped with such data and metrics, we have advanced tools to explore a nearly countless set of urban design and management approaches to balance urban quality of life with many other considerations and goals, far more than we've ever been able to do before with new computational tools and cheaper computational power. So, some references on these things that I mentioned, and I'll let Martha move on to the next speaker.